In 1968, the Haystack Mountain School of Crafts walked out of the studio and into the kitchen. That summer, Haystack held a special culinary session. This three-week cooking class was designed to extend Haystack's core studios outside of the craft disciplines, or it was designed to treat cooking as a craft. The culinary session appears to be the only time that a cooking class has been held at any American craft school. Archived correspondence between the school's first director, Francis S. Merritt, and various contacts in the craft and cooking worlds reveal that Haystack was interested in cooking as a skilled performance that made the best out of simple tools and simple surroundings. The potter and poet M.C. Richards, who served as a baking instructor for the culinary session, remarked in a letter to Merritt, "As usual, I'm interested in how you use your imagination with food when you don't have much. In these videos, I'm going to make my way through the history of American cooking spaces, considering them as spaces of creativity, like the studio or the stage. These spaces, the hearth, the dining room, and the kitchen, have made the food that we eat and also created the norms and discourse of cooking. In every recipe, the key ingredient is language." We're starting at the hearth. Until the 19th century, home cooking in the northeastern United States was done in the hearth. In its simplest form, a hearth is any flat surface that you can build a fire on, stone or brick that can safely retain and radiate heat through the building. It's the center of the house. You cook here, of course, but because it's the main source of heat and light, it's also the place where you do everything else. That means eating, handicrafts done in the evening hours, like whittling or sewing, and also reading, writing, conversation, and entertainment. The hearth is the site of language. The hearth is a place for mouths. This open mouth, yawning warm exhalations through the room, is the symbolic center of the room even when it is absent. It speaks, it sings, it eats wood and sighs out smoke. Fireplaces like this one are inefficient heaters, and yet as open cooking spaces were replaced by stoves over the early 19th century, we mourned the loss of the hearth, periodically coming back to it in fits of nostalgia and a search for simpler pleasures. For Haystack's culinary session, Francis Merritt was keen to include what he called a primitive happening, some type of event that would use historical cooking techniques. Our attraction to learning or relearning these primitive craft knowledges reveals our longing for something that we imagine modern technology has cost us, the communal warmth of food and conversation, a better kind of orality. In the schedule for the culinary session, M.C. Richards is listed as the instructor for a one-day class called Breads from Many Lands. In her correspondence with Merritt, she enthusiastically puts herself forward to teach baking, asking, "Do you need me to do whole wheat pizzas or whole grain honey buns?" She wants to incorporate food traditions from around the world, what would later be called ethnic cuisine. Here, both Richards and Merritt are widening their interest in craft and folk traditions to gulp at other types of imagined authenticity. They bring together their ideas about the primitive and the exotic into a racialized assemblage of appropriations. Given Richard's interest in simple cooking and regional diversity, I feel confident that she taught at least one kind of flatbread from one of those many lands. Maybe lavash from Armenia, matzah from Palestine, or tortillas from Central America. Today I'm making roti, a South Asian flatbread. I'm learning this method from Yamini Joshi, an expert cook who grew up in Mumbai and now lives in Queens, New York, where she teaches cooking. Joshi has graciously allowed me to demonstrate her recipes. First, the raita. This flavorful yogurt sauce will accompany our roti. To make it, add crushed mustard seeds along with chilies, cilantro, and mint to a bowl with yogurt. In a separate bowl, grate a generous half of an English cucumber. Peel the cucumber lengthwise, leaving a strip of skin on one side. Hold the cucumber with the strip of skin against your hand. The cucumber skin will protect your human skin from the grater. Grate in the onions next. Now put your cucumber and onion into a strainer and press on the solids to expel as much liquid as possible. This will keep your raita from becoming too runny, and the liquid will be incorporated into the roti dough to flavor the bread. When I asked Joshi about this ingenious method of flavoring, she pointed out that a lot of flavor in cooking can go to waste.
So when you're bringing from the store and you're paying a $5 for that vegetable, so that maximum amount of that vegetable you have to use to for your eating, because it's a natural thing, you do not have to waste it. Inside the juice, all the vegetable, that's, everything is edible. Nothing is extra to throw it out. Why you want to throw?
Once you've saved your vegetable liquid, put the solids into the yogurt bowl and add some salt, a pinch of sugar, and some cumin powder. Stir the raita and set it aside. Now you can take your vegetable liquid to the hearth and start your roti dough. First, put 2 cups of atta, a fine whole grain wheat flour, into a wide, flat bowl. Add salt. Now pour your vegetable liquid into the flour and mix, adding water as necessary. Once the dough comes together, knead for 10 minutes, or until the dough is stretchy and doesn't stick to your hands. Yamini Joshi has been teaching for over a decade with the League of Kitchens, an organization that employs immigrant women cooks to teach classes in the cuisine of their homelands. Before the COVID-19 pandemic, Joshi invited her students into her home to learn these recipes, and now classes are held over Zoom. While she has some difficulty communicating strictly verbally to students what their textures and flavors should be, with dough, she can tell if it's right just by looking at it.
And I can see the dough, how you're making it. I can stretch it. So you can also stretch. And if it is not breaking, so that means the stretch is perfect in the way about I want it. But if it is breaking or it is sticky, then I have to make them to fix it. You need a little more water. Yes, little more water. If you're kneading properly, the dough has to be textured like soft and smooth, like, you know, stretchy, nothing like breakable, not porsy or not like any knots on it or something like that.
Joshi says that teaching students like me, some of whom have never cooked before, is a source of pride. Her own culinary training was hard won as a new daughter-in-law in the kitchen of her husband's family in India, where she was expected to cook for long hours and always defer to the family and their tastes. Now she cooks her own way.
After a lot of years of this training, I feel like I get the freedom to show my expertise, you know. I'm free woman now. Before that, I'm under somebody. It's like somebody's on my top. So I had to ask many times. So I had to follow their rules. Now I have no rules. I cook by my freedom way and make my own flavor and feed the people, because I know whatever I'm cooking, they definitely love it.
Joshi's expertise and creativity are evident in her teaching. She loves to see students awaken to new ways of learning, using their hands and eyes and mouths in the process. She herself is exploring. With her firm foundation and technique, she has freedom to experiment, blending and blooming flavors in novel ways. MC Richards did this too. I can imagine her here, pulling and kneading bread dough like she would wedge clay, in dialogue with her materials. In her book, Centering in Pottery, Poetry, and the Person, Richards writes, "It is the physicality of the crafts that pleases me. I learn through my hands and my eyes and my skin what I could never learn through my brain." Each turn in the dough is a speech act. Each stretch is a poem. Each fold is an education. Cooking, like pottery or poetry, is a method of inquiry. Each cook asks a question. Making these pinch pots, a form of vessel that Richards found inexhaustibly fascinating, I move the clay around. I feel my hand press the pot, dragging my fingers in swipes or pressing small scallops, asking for the shape. As I start to roll my roti into discs, I see the shape I want in my mind. I'm using a chakla, a small round board, to guide my rolling pin. I center my dough on the wheel.
A chakla is a round shape, so your mind always focus here to make a round shape.
Roll each roti into a round shape and place it on the griddle. Let it cook for about a minute until it bubbles and grows large, dark brown spots. Flip it over and cook for another 30 seconds. Remove from the griddle with tongs and brush the roti with ghee. In centering, Richards remarks, I am an odd bird in both academic and craft worlds, perhaps because I am a poet, and thus by calling, busy with seeing the similarities between things ordinarily thought to be different. Richards is assembling the world in layers, stacking round pursuits on top of each other and then swallowing them whole. Every word, every practice is edible to her, even those things that she might have taken more care about appropriating. To her, food and pottery and philosophy are all the same movement, all coursing through the living vessel of the body in a fiery transformation. Historically, the end of the hearth was marked by a chilly separation anxiety. As 19th century domestic architecture began to embrace separate kitchens and stoves replaced open hearths, fireside poets mourned the descent into modernity. As soon as it stopped being a lived reality, the hearth became an ideology, a place of cozy domesticity and known hungers easily satisfied. Poets cast aside the soot, the drafts, the endless feeding of whole forests worth of wood into the hearth's open mouth. Instead, we choose to imagine a scene of constant chatter and nourishment, the touch of loved ones close at hand, and the sweetness of warm bread.